So I see that I definitely lost Henrik. So you see. So I hope I won't lose anybody anymore. So to avoid this, maybe I will repeat what we have done yesterday. So our basic goal was to investigate this integral as a principle, which is to determine to which extent the set of representation of an integer by a quadratic form in a lattice is non-empty. And so we had a sort of natural candidate for an equivalence, for a criterion for this, which is that what was I called. So here this is D is representable by Q in L. And here, this is this statement, so which is a bit longer, but which is elementary to check. So that the equation, so we want to solve this equation, Q to X equal D. So here we ask for having a solution to this equation in the lattice L, and here we ask to have a solution to this equation in the real vector space and in any of the local lattices attached to L. And here we say this, D is locally representable by Q in L. And so the goal was to give sufficient condition for this to hold. And so I have stated a general result. And so to study this question, and especially to study this condition, we have introduced a family of lattices which are closely related to L, so which was called the Q genus of L. And informally, this is the set of lattices, so L prime of rational lattices, which are locally isometric to L. And so we, as I have explained, this set can be realized as an orbit of the lattice L under the action of some group, where G is an orthogonal group of this quadratic form. And G of AF is a group of adelic points, of finite adelic points of G, which is a set of sequences, GP, where GP in G of QP. Okay, and GP in G of ZP for almost every P. So, because we have said, because any lattice can be completely recovered by the data of its collection of local lattices, we can act on each local lattices and create a new lattice. So, in a sense, why why this set of this genus is natural to consider. Because so when you are aware of the existence of such an action of even the general linear groups on the space on the set of rational lattices, you see that the lattices which are in the Q genus of L are exactly the set of lattices which satisfies this condition if this condition is satisfied for L. So, just because if this set is non-empty for some for LP, then this set will be non-empty if you replace LP by any local lattice isometric to LP. So, in a sense, it's the most natural set to consider when you look at this condition, the most natural family of lattices. And so yesterday we finished on a consequence of the so-called regular as principle, which is when you so the Assumption principle is when you is the equivalence of two conditions like this, where L replaced by the Q vector space Qn and LP replaced by the local vector space Qp to the n. So basically, as a consequence of this definition, so it's just essentially mechanical, the Assumption principle implies that or I should say maybe D is locally representable by Q in L is equivalent to D is representable by Q in sum L prime in the genus of L. So, a priori, we don't necessarily have a representation in the lattice we want, but we have one representation in one of the on these closely, very closely related lattices. Okay, so this is good. But okay, so there is one thing, is that you see, so this set, the genus of L, it's still an infinite set of lattices. Okay, because really you can make a lot of so genus of Q is infinite, but as I explained, this problem has, I would say, additional symmetries. But if, say, RQ of DL prime is non-empty, then this is the case for any other lattices which is globally isometric to L prime. So for any L prime prime, in the rational G orbit of the lattice L. So really the question of representability, it does not, it's not about L prime, but rather on his global isometric class. And now we have a fundamental result, so of Hermit and Minkowski, which says the following, so which says that if you look at the set of of global isometry classes in the genus, so that set is finite. Okay, so and maybe I will continue with the definition. So the cardinality of that set, it may be noted HQ of L, and it's called the Q class number of L. And so this theorem of Hermite-Minkowski, it generalizes the Gauss theorem on the finiteness of the class number of binary quadratic forms. So, and later we will see a further generalization of it in the context of Hadels on algebraic groups. But if we say this and added to this remark about symmetry, loosely you could say, so the integral as a principle holds up to finitely many obstructions. So, being that, the as a principle gives you that you have a representation in some of these lattice classes, but maybe not the one you might want, but there are only finitely many possibilities if the integral as a principle fails. Okay, so. But at least, in particular, so if the class number of the lattice is 1, so if the genus of L is reduced to the global isometry class of the lattice, which is obvious, then the integral as a principle holds. And so there are a number of quadratic form for which this class number is 1. So example, when n is 2, 3, or 4, then you have the square quadratic form, so the Euclidean quadratic form. And in that way, you recover the theorems of Fermat, Legendre, and Lagrange about sum of two squares, three squares, and four squares. It's a discriminant quadratic form. So this one has class number 1, 2. But in general, the class number is greater than 1. And so then you have something to prove. So maybe I will just say a few words of what happens. So maybe I should say there is one case which is maybe easier than the other. So if Q is indefinite, So the class number may not be 1, but HQ of L is small. Small, what do I mean by small? Is small in terms of, so the natural numerical invariant which measures the complexity of the quadratic form in terms of the discriminant of the quadratic form, so relative to the lattice L. So you take a basis of L, and then you form the Gram matrix, and you compute the determinant of it. So I will define it as a discriminant, even if maybe it's not the okay. And so of the size of the discriminant. In fact, if it is indefinite, the class number which be basically 2 to the power the number of so will be less than 2 to the number of maybe prime factors of the discriminant. So it's very small. But if Q is definite, and then HQ of L grows polynomially with the discriminant. And even a precise formula. So for this, you need make some primitivity assumption on the lattice L, say that it has to be maximal if Q is integral on it. But OK, so it's a vague statement. Probably it should be n minus 1. So something like this. So it's pretty quick grow. So okay. So then you see in general you basically cannot escape the Hasse principle for the most general quadratic forms. So you cannot escape these obstructions, except in a few cases.
Well, at least if the rank is 4 and Q is indefinite, it holds.
Always, even for very okay. So okay, good. So it's. Good, I trust you. Sure. Okay, nevertheless, the Adelic treatment enables you to completely ignore the issue of being definite or indefinite. So, even if. So, okay, it may simplify things, create difficulty on the other side. So, what do I want to do? Okay. Yeah. So now I want to explain a strategy to cope with these obstructions. And just for the second, I will not need this. Don't need it. So I remind you what we had, that we had a representation in some lattice L prime, which was given to us by the Hasse principle. And so we have at least one. And we will start from this representation to build new ones. OK. And And the way to do this, so we will consider H, the subgroup, so we take the stabilizer of this vector in the orthogonal group. So this is an algebraic subgroup of the orthogonal group, which is an orthogonal group in n minus one variable, because it's the orthogonal group of the quadratic form when you restrict it to the orthocomplement of the vector x. Okay, xq is not zero. So you introduce this this subgroup, and now look at this orbit. So you take now the adelic point of this subgroup, and you consider the lattice L prime, so which is of course contained into to the full L prime, which is just the Q genus of L. So, and so consider some lattice in that subset of the full genus. So, what do you have? So what does it mean? So you have that, say, let's say, write L prime prime to be HF L prime, so which means HF is a collection of local of matrices contained in the local group attached to H, and so you have L prime prime P is HP times L prime P for every P. But now you have the equation that xq is in L prime P because of this. So, and if you apply HP to each of these, so, and because xq is contained in all the local lattices, then you have that xq is also in L prime prime. Okay? And of course, xq, is, this vector has not moved at all. So it means that q of xq is d. So it means that xq belongs to the set of representation of d by L prime. But what is important here is that L prime prime, this new lattice, does not necessarily belong to the global isometric class of L prime. Okay? A priori, because you have not acted by a rational matrix, you have acted by an adelic element. Okay? So potentially, one has created a new representation in the sense that L prime may be new, may not be an obvious representation that you could have gotten from this representation just by acting trivially by global isometry. Okay, so now, suppose, so then, because you have a new lattice, suppose that this lattice L prime prime belong instead to G of Q of L. So then it means what? It means that xq belong to gq L for some global element, and then you have x prime q, which is gq minus one xq, which is a vector belong to L. Okay, so what you have is that, so let's write it that way. So we started from a lattice L prime, and out of this lattice we constructed a family of lattices, which is so contained in the genus, and the genus, I recall you, it's the union, say, of global isometric lattices. So if this orbit meets the global isometric class we are interested in, we have obtained a representation in the lattice we want. Okay, so it's a bit strange because we start from a representation, so from a vector, so we do not move the vector, a priori we move the lattice. But of course, so you see that when you really get a new representation because isq is twisted by this global element. And so that's the strategy to prove this. So the goal is so show. In fact, what we will show is somewhat stronger because there is no reason to that L has a more special role than any other lattice in the genus. We'll show that. So if you look at this orbit of L prime, so give sufficient conditions so that when you look at the orbit at this orbit and you project it on the genus, so what you want to show is that this projection map is surjective. So then you see this is a statement about sort of, it's a dynamical statement. You have a space on which a big group acts. So in fact, the space is an homogeneous space. The genus is an homogeneous space of under the action of this group because it's an orbit. And you take a subgroup of the big group, and you look at an orbit in this subgroup, and you want to know does the orbit completely fill the space? Okay. Is it so? Maybe it may be a bit disturbing this way of seeing. So is there a question? Or? No, okay. So and this is a strategy that that can be, so the claim is that, so with respect to what I have explained in the beginning, we need to show that there exists x, I remind you. So basically, the statement was that the integral as a principle holds whenever d is sufficiently large and satisfies a set of additional conditions at anisotropic primes and so on. So what we need to show is that for d large enough, so plus additional condition, which were spelled in there exists a representation xq such that hf, so this orbit is growing, so becomes bigger and bigger. So here is a silly example where you may have an orbit which is not growing, which a priori you cannot exclude, because okay, the Hasse principle does not tell you much about this except this, its existence. So example where it would not work, assume that is growing as d grows. So example, suppose that d is of the shape d naught d1 square. Okay, so then suppose you have an x naught such that you start from a representation such that q of x naught equals d naught. So then you see that x is d1 x naught, so which is a very non-primitive vector. So is a representation of d, but the stabilizer h is h of, so let's say h of x is just the stabilizer of x naught, so because it's a scalar multiple of this, does not as d1 goes to infinity. So you have some small problem related to imprimitivity, but so this can be solved, or if you are happy with additional assumptions, say, I don't know, if you are happy with saying that d will be square-free or will have a bounded valuation of every prime, this will not occur. Okay, so I will ignore this. This is a merely a technical point. So, so under the condition I have given, you can always find a good representation out of the one you started from, which will be an imprimitive vector. So, maybe not imprimitive, but at least when this group will be growing. So. Yeah.
Could you please trace how the right-hand side, that is, h of a rho, depends on d? Just general stuff.
So d h will depend on d. Yes.
So could you please just show the briefly?
Oh, because xq depends on d. So if d moves and you avoid such situation, your torus will move.
So is it just xq?
What?
So the
if xq is imprimitive, yeah.
It's so basically, just you set the d that determines xq, and that will determine the dependency of h a rho l prime on d.
Yeah, but you have to choose. You have to choose xq, and if you don't want to make a choice, assume, say, that d is square-free, then as d varies among square-free integers, you will have the good variation of h, too. Okay. Is it something clear? Okay.
So this covers the exceptional cases?
No, because, okay, so because there, so in the case of exceptional square classes, so okay, so what I will explain is that then this such a statement that you cover the full space will be, so one, we will prove something stronger, that in fact the orbit, when projected there, will be equidistributed. So we want to prove that it is equidistributed, meaning that we will have to integrate the orbit along a test function on that space. And so for most test functions, so the one associated to cuspidal automorphic forms, there will be no problem. But you have also test functions which are characters, associated to characters. And in this case, it may be that if the D is in a bad square class, your character will be trivial. So your character will be globally non-trivial, but will be trivial along the orbit. So you cannot have a sort of equidistribution. So in this representation, the exceptional square classes will come from the so-called the residual spectrum of the adelic group. So, but so in order to know these extra obstruction, you have to know the shape of the lattice L, because then you need to know which are the characters which can occur, and so you know how to. So you can. You told me that you have conditions to.
The statement you made that if this is big enough, and you only look at let's say primitive elements.
Yeah.
Is it true even in the case when you have exceptional classes?
Here I have put additional condition. Oh, yeah. So no. But the group still, the group H will grow. And it will fill a good portion of that space, but it will avoid some finite dimension, so some finite places. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So. Maybe, so there is a, so this strategy, okay. So besides the Duke's theorem, there is a very nice place where this strategy is implemented and which goes at a higher level, but in which really it's a dynamical statement, but there is a place where it gets really dynamical is in the paper of Ehlenberg. And Venkatesh. So when they study not representation of an integer by a quadratic form, but when they study representation of a quadratic lattice in a higher rank quadratic lattice. And so you can make just exactly the same reasoning, so accepted that you will not consider stabilizer of a point, but stabilizer of several independent vectors. And so it's an inventionist paper. I don't remember the date exactly. Actually, it's not there. Someone has Google, so if you want, you can check. So there, it's really. So it's the dynamical treatment is somewhat different. Okay. So I wanted to get this. So what I want. Okay. So, but what I want to explain maybe is how this strategy allows you to prove even even more precise statement. So, okay. So suppose now we are proven that for D large enough, and we have added sufficiently many reasonable conditions on D to ensure that we have the integral as a principle for every lattice in the genus. Every one, so because Okay, so then one can look for more refined problems, such as the position. So we know that RQ of D L is non-empty. So what are the positions of the vectors, the x, and then so there is a various way to look at the position or various. So the most obvious one is then so we scale this set of representation by d to the 1/2, and this set is contained into Rn. So plus or minus 1 is the sign of d. And what is this thing? So these are the set of vectors which takes value plus or minus 1, of real vectors taking value plus or minus 1. So this thing is an ellipsoid or an hyperboloid, depending on whether the quadratic form is definite or indefinite. And so this is a fixed space. And so what you may want to look at is for the various L that you are interested in, how does that set fill this space? Or how are these vectors distributed into that hyperboloid? Okay. And so this, by Witt's theorem, this hyperboloid is an homogeneous space. So Witt for G of R. So this thing can be identified with so if you it can be written as an orbit of a single point, let's say X node. So you choose your favorite point here, and you take the orbit, and you obtain the full space. And so as such, it's homogeneous. So X node does not need to be rational. It's a real vector. And so because this is a homogeneous space, it admits JR invariant measure, so which is uniquely defined up to scalar, which comes from taking the quotient of the R measure on these two groups. And okay, so then one has the following equidistribution statement. So I will, okay, let me fix some notation. So I will write gen q of L here is L1 is L. So just to fix IDs, L2, a set of representative of the genus classes. So I read, okay. So
what does Witt say?
Witt theorem that an orthogonal group acts transitively on a sphere on a, yeah. On the level set of a quadratic form. Okay, so the set of you fix a set of lattices which represent all the various genus classes. So you know that this set of representations are non-empty when D is large enough plus additional conditions. And so the theorem, which is that for all I, so the set is equidistributed on Li, sorry, yeah, is equidistributed on my hyperboloid as D goes to infinity plus conditions. So the condition to guarantee that integral as a principle holds. And specifically, what do I mean by equidistributed? So what, okay. So suppose you take phi 1, phi 2, two compactly supported function on that hyperboloid. Continuous compactly supported, so no problem with so my definition of equidistribution will be serre proof. And so then we assume that so this integral is not zero. Okay, then the ratio so you take, you average over all representations by of D by Q in the lattice Li of psi of xi over D to the 1/2. And so you make the ratio with the same, but with phi 2. So then, this ratio, so for D large enough, it will be well-defined, and it will converge to the ratio of the measures. Okay, and this is valid for every so every choice of representative. So, okay. So in a sense, your integral representations are well distributed. Okay. Yeah.
So as I understand, the D big enough. It depends on the lattice too, right?
Yes.
Not just the quadratic.
Yes. Yes. It depends on the lattice. Yes.
Is there a kind of uniform statement with respect to the lattices?
So, when n equal 3, you may face the Ziegle zero. So maybe, you can make so modulo Ziegle zero issue. You can make something really. So the constant D will depend polynomially on the discriminant of the Q discriminant of the lattice. Okay, so yeah, okay. I want to explain this. How it goes, this equidistribution statement, because I want then to bridge to the full Adélie group. But so I will. Okay. Okay, so what I explain, okay, let me call gamma I to be G of Li, so I mean the stabilizer of the lattice in GQ. So then embedded into GR. So this is a discrete subgroup of GR, and so this is what we said in the beginning. This group acts on the set of representations. So then, which are split into a disjoint union of orbits. Okay, so there is a finiteness theorem that this union is finite. And it's a variation of on the Hermite-Minkowski theorem. So here this is a finite, so the set of representation splits into a finite union of gamma I orbits. So when we will analyze our sum, so let's look at the numerator. So we will split it into according to these orbits. And so this is what we want to evaluate. So, okay, so this is a phi, this phi is a phi one, say phi is phi one or phi two. Okay, so now what is phi? Phi, it's a function on this hyperboloid, but because of this identification of phi, you can view phi as a, okay. You can view phi as a function on GR, which is equal on GR, which is right H X naught of R invariant. Yeah, I want to explain duality principle. So this is a function which is right in invariant on the right, and okay. So and the compactly supported function on that quotient, you can you may assume that they are of a specific shape. So by density, that psi is of the following shape, so psi of, let me say, x equals so it's something of that shape for and phi a compactly supported function on GR. So the space, the compactly supported function and the quotient are generated by this function, which are obtained, which are made invariant by averaging. So then what we are looking at, so it's a sum over these orbits of a sum over gammas in gamma I of integral, an H integral of this phi of gamma I, gi with a Hubb notation, h note, dh note. And okay, and this we can, you can just switch summation and see this as a sum over this orbit of integral of x naught of, okay, what is my, okay, we'll call it little phi of gamma I g I h naught dh naught, yeah, where phi of gamma I g is just the function which is obtained by averaging over gamma of big phi of gamma g. So, and this is a function which is continuous, compactly supported on the quotient gr modulo gamma I. Okay. So the so this, by what I've made, that I explained, so the equidistribution statement meant for the representations RQ of D, RQ of D LI, it's equivalent to an equidistribution statement. So for RQLI on this ellipsoid, it's equivalent to an equidistribution statement for a collection of H X naught of R orbits in the space in the quotient JR modulo gamma I. Okay, so it's a standard duality principle. So, and so here then you see we are looking for an equidistribution problem in the quotient of a group, a discrete subgroup. So now we start to smell automorphic forms. But here, so it's a statement in a sense which was made on purpose. It was made for individual gamma i's. However, it's much better if you want to try to solve this problem, it's much better to look at it as an equidistribution statement for a collection of H X naught R orbits in the following space, in this disjoint union okay, and I will explain next time that this thing is naturally identified with the following quotient. So you take Gr times GAF divided by GQ modulo this group, so G of L hat Okay? And okay, it's a bit false, but plus the collection and the collection of orbits. So what is it? The collection of orbits can be realized as the projection on that quotient of the orbit. So HR times HAF times let me say just the L prime that we started with. So the HAF is the Adélie group which was introduced here from our primitive representation. So so then, in a sense, when we want to prove the more precise version, so this equidistribution theorem, we have to look not only at how this Adélie orbit equidistribute in the space of classes of rational lattices, but we will have to look at how this big sort of complete orbit equidistributes in this big Adélie quotient. And so to study this equidistribution problem, you have to analyze this quotient and things like this. Okay, thank you.
Yes?
Can we think RQDL as a Hicke operator acting on the symmetric space D-modic?
No, it's what would be a Hicke operator?
RQDL, the axon on the left of RQDLI.
Where?
The top board, topmost board.
Which one?
The topmost board, yeah, second line of the topmost board.
Topmost? No, it's not Hicke operator. No, so when n is 4, this thing can be interpreted in terms of Hicke operators, but not so this orbit. Yeah, you can relate it to Hicke operators, and the resolution comes from bounds for eigenvalues of Hicke operators. But for n is 3, this orbit is related to L functions.